How to find the p-value. Once you've identified the null and alternative hypotheses and calculated the test statistic, then to find the p-value, you make note of the symbol that's used in H1, or the alternative hypothesis. Since it's a not equal to, this is a two-tailed test. And if I were to draw the normal curve to get a pictorial representation of what I'm looking for, I would put the test statistic Z here. I would shade this tail, but because it's a two-tailed test, there is a mirror image tail over here. I can find the area associated with this tail looking in the Z-score chart. This is one way to find the p-value. And if you look up 2.53 in the positive z-score chart, this is the z-score chart. When I look up 2.53, let me go to the positive one, here you go, then what I have is the area of, let's see, 2.50123, 0.9943. But remember, that gives us the area from this mark to the left. So that's the area there. So 0.9943. How do I find the area shaded in this tail? I subtract this number from 1, 0.9943, and that's going to give me 0.0057. That would potentially be my p-value if this was a one-tailed test. Now, do not round this to 0.0060 as what the answer was that you put in, but instead leave it 0.0057, but because it's a two-tailed test, you have to double it. So doubling that would actually give you 0.0057 times 2, which is, that's a 2, 0.0114. Now you notice that this has 0.0108, but there is a tolerance that's used because we have a table that we're referring to instead of a calculator to find a better approximation of the area under the curve for this particular piece. So the last thing I'll show you is how to use your calculator to find the p-value, because I know you have a TI-83. So when you turn on your calculator, if you go to, let me turn it on here. Let me get it moved up to turn it on. All right. Come on. Come on. Okay, there we go. In the stat menu under tests, we are conducting a one sample proportion Z test. So I arrow down to one sample proportion Z test. And it's fine with me for you to use your calculator to find p-values, because it's going to give you a better estimate of the p-value than what you'll get from the table. Now I'm going to enter that selection, and then I need to type in the values that I'm given from the problem. I know p sub o is what this says, which is actually our h sub o. So it's the P without the hat. It's the what we assume to be the population proportion. So in this case, it's 0.25. And then it asks for X and N. Well, X is the number of successes out of the total number of adults in this case. But instead of giving us an X number, they calculate that at 27%. So 27% of 3,000, let me do this real quick, 27% of 3,006 is 811.62. So I'm going to estimate the X to be 812, and remember there will be some tolerance there. And then our N is 3,006. This is going to show whether we're using a two-tailed test, which is what we have, always look in H1, a one-tailed test left tail, or a one-tailed test right tail. And we've selected the two-tailed test, pop down there to calculate, hit enter, and look, there is the Z number, which is a little higher than ours, 2.55, if we round like we're supposed to the hundredths place. And then the p-value is 0.0108, which agrees with the answer that's there. So it already, you know, automatically does that. Now, why are these numbers slight? Why is the z basically slightly off? Well, look at the p-hat. P-hat using 812 over 3006 is not just 27%, it's 27.01264138%. So, you know, you will experience some slight calculation differences, but I understand that when I grade what you do, I give it a tolerance that I know you should be within the actual answers. So hopefully that helped, and that's the way that you find the p-value.